This is how Mr. Micawber, a character in Charles Dickens' 1850 novel, David Copperfield, described the act of procrastination. Never do tomorrow what you can do today. Procrastination is the thief of time. Procrastination has a pretty poor reputation, and those who procrastinate regularly are perceived as being inherently lazy and lacking in self-discipline. And yet, for something so awful and so terribly bad, procrastination is an almost universal experience. That's because according to most surveys, around 20% of the adult population would describe themselves as being chronic procrastinators. And as many as 80 to 95% of college students admit to procrastinating on a regular basis. And the problem is that procrastination isn't exactly harmless. There is plenty of evidence which suggests that chronic procrastinators suffer from higher overall levels of stress, have reduced job and academic performance, and are generally in worse physical health than those who don't procrastinate. Which begs the question, why do it? The answer may not be what you would necessarily expect, because it has less to do with laziness and a lack of self-discipline, and more to do with how your brain perceives the particular task at hand, and finally decides to do or not to do what it knows needs to be done eventually. My name is Hashem, and I'm a University of Cambridge graduate and student doctor, and this is my YouTube channel, Neuron Theory, where I spend a lot of time reading journal papers and share all the good bits with you guys. And today I'm going to look at what happens inside the brain when we decide to put something off for no good reason, even though we know it needs to be done. Hopefully, this should help you better understand the reasons why you procrastinate, which I personally think is probably the best first step that you can take to improving your overall productivity if that's what you want to do. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon, and now, let's all procrastinate for the next 8 minutes or so. Procrastination is the act of intentionally deciding that you're not going to do something that you know needs to be done eventually. In other words, you're postponing the inevitable, knowing that there may be consequences or a price to pay down the line. For example, you don't need to have Timothée Chalamet's prescient abilities nor his oracular vision to know that leaving an essay that you need to write to the very, very last minute will almost certainly result in significantly more stress and could potentially impact your overall grade for that class. But before you make that decision, to forget about the essay and spend the next 8 hours mindlessly scrolling on Reddit, what do you actually feel? You most likely will feel conflicted. That's because when you're trying to decide whether you should do something now or later, there is an actual tug of war happening inside your brain. First, there is the limbic system, also known as the paleomammalian brain. This is one of the oldest parts of the brain and plays an important role in regulating your behavior by tapping into your most base instincts. It helps you survive by pulling you away from unpleasant situations. Your prefrontal cortex, on the other hand, is the newer and more sophisticated part of your brain. It helps you plan, organize, and think things through, thus also regulating your behavior and helping you to survive. However, your prefrontal cortex does this by pushing you towards the unpleasant situation. In other words, while your limbic system is mainly concerned with the short-term costs of a particular action, your prefrontal cortex has the nuance to understand the value of long-term rewards and understand that these long-term rewards may be worth the initial cost or unpleasantness. But because the limbic system is older and much more well-established, it very often ends up winning this battle, convincing you to avoid writing the essay now because that would be a lot of work. And where your limbic system is concerned, work, unless it's for food or sex, is just unpleasant. Now, while the key areas of the limbic system are the amygdala, which play an important role in processing our emotions and making us feel Well, scared, which is important because several studies have shown that we're far more likely to avoid or postpone a particular task if that task appears to be daunting or difficult, because we're just afraid that we might not do well at it. Some people would refer to that as being performance anxiety. But here's where it gets really interesting. Research has shown that chronic procrastinators tend to have larger amygdalae, indicating that they may have more overall power over the decision-making process. Moreover, the amygdalae in chronic procrastinators were significantly less connected to the dorsal anterior cingulate cortex. The dorsal anterior cingulate cortex plays a vital role in reward anticipation, and it's believed that it helps to rein in the amygdala by telling the amygdala that though it might be scared and though this might be a lot of hard work, it's still worth it because there's a reward waiting for it at the end of the tunnel. Like a paycheck, which you need for, rent, food, and to pay off the mountains of student debt you now have, but I digress. And people who experience more stress in their lives tend to have larger amygdalae, which kind of makes sense when you think of what stress is. When you tell a friend that you're stressed out, what you actually mean is that you're worried, or you're scared that you might not do well on an exam, might not have time to finish the project that you're currently working on, or might lose your job. All these things, they stress you out. They scare you. And the thing about chronic stress is that it completely changes your way of thinking, effectively rewiring your brain, making you more hesitant by drawing on past negative experiences and mistakes, effectively making you freeze rather than take action and do what you consciously know you need to do. These individuals will perform worse under pressure and will avoid the work they need to do for as long as possible. Not because they're lazy like many people assume, but because they're so stressed out, meaning their amygdalae are effectively holding the rest of their brain to ransom. Which is probably why this phenomenon is known as amygdala hijack. But even the worst procrastinators will eventually sit down to write that essay, even if it's on the night before that essay is due. However, that won't be because their amygdala finally relinquished control and stopped pulling them away from the unpleasant situation, essay writing in this case. Their amygdala are still pulling them away from a different unpleasant situation. In this case, the unpleasant situation changed from essay writing to potentially failing that class. The way I see it is that even when a procrastinator sits down to write their essay the night before it's due, they're still motivated by fear and stress, and they're still running away rather than towards the outcome. This is only possible because closer to the deadline, the outcome changed. In summary, the next time someone tells you that they work better under pressure, you can tell them, no the fuck you don't, you're just motivated by stress and fear, a consequence of your oversized amygdala. And this situation is probably not helped by the fact that we don't really identify with our future selves any more than we identify with a complete stranger. But what do I mean by this? So there have been several studies which were able to show that when we think about our future selves, our brains show the same activation patterns as when we think or conjure a complete stranger in our minds. The obvious implications of this is that we're far, far less likely to treat our future self kindly. This may explain why people are less likely to save for retirement even though they know their future self needs financial security, lose weight even though they know it will make their future self happy if they did, and a bunch of other stuff, including doing some of the work now and not procrastinating until the very last minute, because that will make your life easier and less stressful for your future self. And if you want to learn more about procrastination, and specifically when procrastination can be a force for good, like under certain conditions when it stimulates creativity, then you should probably subscribe and wait until next week, because that's what we're going to be doing next week. I also post all my references on my free newsletter on Substack, and I also include fun extras, so if you want to read the full research papers yourself, you're more than welcome to. You should find a link in the description below. And finally, if this video has helped you in any way, then please give this video a thumbs up and tell me in the comments what your favorite part was. See you all next week, and remember that everyone procrastinates every now and then, except maybe for Taylor Swift, also known as the hardest working person in the world right now.